Hi everyone, we're here at McMaster University in Hamilton, Ontario, where tons of innovative research happens every day. One of these labs is working on creating a device that will have a massive impact on our tiniest humans.
This emerging technology is coming from the Center for Advanced Microelectrophysics, research institute found right on campus. This lab has been helping premature babies with difficulties breathing.
Many premature infants experience difficulty breathing because their respiratory system has not fully developed by the time that they are born. In short, gas exchange occurs in small sacs within our lungs called alveoli, which are covered in a solution called surfactant. Surfactant is needed to keep airways open for breathing, and without it, the alveoli would collapse. A fetus starts making surfactant in the womb. However, premature infants born before 37 weeks gestation may not have made enough surfactant. This is why many preterm infants may experience lung impairment. This lung impairment may progress to respiratory distress syndrome, or RDS, where the infant will need assistance breathing from a device. Although technologies exist to help with breathing, there are drawbacks when using these devices in this small and vulnerable population.
Currently, mechanical ventilation serves as the main intervention for treating preterms with respiratory distress syndrome. However, mechanical ventilation can damage the lungs and cause a series of pulmonary complications. Some complications include infection to one or both lungs and rupturing of the membranes. If mechanical ventilation proves to be unsuccessful for treating respiratory distress syndrome, then the preterm is placed on extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, also known as ECMO, which comes with its own drawbacks. One of the main issues with ECMO is that it is highly invasive as it requires a surgery to access the main blood vessels. Additionally, ECMO requires a lot of blood, and a typical 1 kg preterm's body only contains 7 tablespoons of blood. At this point, you may be wondering why this issue can't be solved with adult donor blood. Well, the issue with using adult blood is that it is different from the blood of a newborn. Baby's blood cells have a higher affinity for oxygen when compared to those of adults.
To circumvent many of these problems, the researchers at the Center for Advanced Microelectrophysics created the artificial placenta. This device gets its name because it functions to provide oxygen to a newborn in the same manner that a placenta would provide oxygen in the womb. In the womb, a fetus is surrounded by amniotic fluid, so it cannot get oxygen from its lungs, which are also still developing. Instead, the fetus's umbilical arteries carry deoxygenated blood to the placenta. In the placenta, the mother's oxygenated blood meets with the fetus's deoxygenated blood at the chorionic membrane where gas exchange occurs. The oxygenated blood then returns to the fetus through the umbilical vein and is pumped throughout its body.
The artificial placenta device works under the same premise. However, instead of gas exchange occurring within the body, it occurs in the outside air. After birth, the umbilical cord is cut, detaching it from the placenta. The baby is then able to take its first breath using its own lungs. However, in the case of an infant needing assistance breathing, this device would be connected to the umbilical artery and vein where the placenta was previously attached. The infant's heart would pump deoxygenated blood to the device. Within the artificial placenta device, gas exchange would occur. Then, oxygenated blood would return to the infant through the umbilical vein. This is a passive process because hospitals would not have to manage the device. Rather, the body's natural self-regulation process controls the blood pressure and flow and pumps the baby's blood through the device. The idea behind the artificial placenta device offers a promising solution to newborn respiratory distress. Researchers in the lab are currently testing the device in animal trials so that it can one day be used in hospitals.
One of the master's students working in this lab has offered to show us around their lab and give a look at some of the developments they're making with their device.
Hello everyone, this is Neda Saraei. I'm a master's student at biomedical engineering. Over the last decade, our research group has been using microfabrication technologies to overcome the shortcoming of hollow fiber membranes and introduce the next generation of blood oxygenators. Microfluidic blood oxygenators have shown promising improvement in gas exchange compared to convection ECMO, due to mimicking nature lungs by reducing the size of blood channels as small as capillaries in the lung. Our approach is different from other groups active in this area. Typically, any oxygenators, including macrophorotic ones, has three main components: the blood compartment, the gas compartment, and a gas permeable membrane or hollow fibers. Macrophorotic oxygenators have been developing do not have gas channels or chamber. Therefore, they can provide the required gas transfer simply in room air as our lungs do. Our macrophorotic blood oxygenator consists of two non-porous membrane inlets, one outlet, and a blood vascular network responsible for distributing blood uniformity between two gas permeable membranes. We also design and develop a composite gas permeable membrane for our oxygenators, which improves the mechanical stability of our devices. This membrane is made of PDMS, a silicon-based polymer that plays a central role in the gas transfer, and a porous Teflon membrane acts as a scaffold to reinforce PDMS that does not have excellent mechanical properties.
Dr. Ravi Selvaganapathy and his team are currently in the clinical validation stages of this project. The team believes that once the validation stages are completed, there is a potential for this innovation to expand to other areas.
Currently, animal trials have shown that this innovation can support newborns weighing 1 to 2 kilograms. The team is hoping that in the future, they can extend this technology to young children and eventually even the adult population.
Another way they plan to expand this technology is to modify it so that it can supply nutrients in addition to oxygen. Adding this to the future would allow the artificial placenta to support more conditions, since as of right now, it's restricted to only supporting newborns with RDS.
The future of artificial placenta technology is promising and would have significant implications here in Canada and abroad. Dr. Ravi explains these implications further.
After a cannulation, then it has very minimal risk because there is no pumping of the blood, there is no external connections, there is no requirement for power, so it doesn't require any power to operate, and it is designed to get oxygen from air rather than any specialized enriched oxygen source, and therefore you can use it in a variety of settings, even where there's no power or there's no oxygen cylinders and things of that sort. So it is a convenient way for many hospitals, not only in Canada but also across the world, to provide oxygenation support when ECMO is not always available.
Before we can see the benefits of this device in society, future directions of research include extending the length of time it can be used for, assessing possible good or bad long-term effects on the heart or brain, and finally, testing the technology in a clinical trial on real babies.
There is still a long way to go and a lot of developments to be made, but this device would revolutionize the way we look at medicine. It exemplifies how valuable it can be to create technologies that mimic concepts from our natural bodily systems to solve unique medical problems.